Welcome to The Valley Today, a public service presentation of KAIL-TV. We travel south to Porterville and take a historical walk through time to early California. Find examples of early American Indian artifacts, and the first pioneers and settlers to the region have left their mark and tools. Join us as we visit with the docents of this fantastic collection, the Porterville Historical Museum, up next on The Valley Today. And welcome to The Valley Today here at the Porterville Museum in beautiful downtown Porterville, and with Bill Horst.
Yes.
Is that correct, Horst?
That's correct.
All right, I got it right. And you're a docent here and a local historian.
Local historian, most people call me. I've been interested in history of our area since I was very small.
Yeah.
And asked all the old guys what happened.
Yeah. And so you're kind of the conduit, because you're not that old, so you're the conduit between the past and the present.
That's a compliment. Yeah. I am 79, I will
say. You are, really?
Yeah.
I wouldn't have suspected you were a day over 55.
You know, the old timers used
to
say.
That's good living.
Yeah, they always.
This guy's 70, look at him. He's 79 years old, you believe that?
That's a good, clean living.
That's that good, clean living.
The old timers always said, you gotta spend a lot of time in the mountains, because meat don't spoil in the mountains.
So. I've never heard that one before. That's a good one.
Yep.
Now give us a history of how Porterville came to be. And that was about 150 years ago, wasn't
it? Yeah, 152 now. And it started out as just a stopping place on the old Stockton-Los Angeles Road, which was an Indian trail, of course, before that. And everybody going north to the gold mines went through here, and of course, when the Butterfield Overland Stage Company started, they ran the southern route and came around through LA and up through here. One of the stopping places or stations was here on Tule River, and it was simply called that, Tule River.
Tule River.
Then in 1858, 9, 60, 61, and Civil War started. Butterfield stage lines folded because of the southern sympathy in the Missouri, Texas area. The southern route couldn't be used. But in about 1862, Porter Putnam showed up in the area, actually middle of 1861, 62, and by 1863 had bought 40 acres and laid out a town. By 1864, had a stopping place built, and it became a place on Tule River to go. There was another Putnam here who had been the agent for the Butterfield Stage Company out on the south side of Tule River. His name was Charles Putnam.
Hmm.
They were not related, but Porter was here on this north side of Tule River, Charles on the southern side of Tule River. And if you were going to meet someone on Tule River, you were going to meet them at Putnam's. Well, which one?
Yeah.
Porter's place or Charlie's place?
Mm-hmm.
So it became Porter's place because Charles Putnam left the area in about 1866. And by late 1860s, it was known as Porterville.
Oh, okay.
And they sometimes added an S and called it Portersville.
Yeah.
But basically known as Porterville from about 1865 to 1870 on down to modern times. And it grew around Porter Putnam's first hotel and store. And that was the downtown street in Porterville, Main Street, which is where the old Stockton-Los Angeles Road went.
Now, are there any remnants of any of these original buildings?
No, there's not.
They're all gone, huh?
They're all gone. They got updated over the last 100+ years. In 1961, we celebrated a centennial here because at that time, everybody thought that Porter Putnam had landed here and started the stage stop in 1861. But there again, the mix-up between Charles Putnam and Porter Putnam was involved in later years, and research was not done until in 1961, we had a big celebration, and I started asking questions and digging deeper, found out nobody really knew.
Yeah.
So it's been rewritten.
Now you have a dealership, a car dealership here that's Putnam, isn't it?
No.
In Porterville?
No.
Or is there?
We have a street called Putnam, which is just here on the south side of the museum. Mm-hmm. But no car dealership.
Okay, I was wondering, there's still family, the descendants?
Not anymore.
Not anymore, huh?
No, there was up until about 30, 40 years ago.
Yeah. Now, did they, was there gold suspected to be in this area?
Not a lot on Tule River. There was gold north of here, of course, in the Mariposa coarse gold area, and still is. Mm-hmm. And there was gold found down on White River in the hills.
Out of Kernville?
No, it's really, that's the Kern River strike.
Well, okay.
That's on the other side of the ridge of Sierra. But to get there, people in 1854, 55, when the Kern River gold rush started, had to come through here to get there. Mm-hmm. They got their goods, stores, whatever they needed in Visalia, and came through Tule River. Mm-hmm. And this place got a little more popular as a stopping place.
Well, a little closer to.
When there was water. Our river doesn't always have water all year round.
Right.
And they'd go down and across the Greenhorn Mountains toward Lake Isabella area. And going there, you had to cut across up what we now call White River. Mm-hmm. And they started prospecting along the way, found gold in White River. Later that was called a place named Tail Holt or Tail Hold. And interesting story, at the time gold was found in 1850s, it was found on Coarse Gold Gulch, which is near White River, just south. Mm-hmm. Then they found gold in 1860 in White River proper. And that then by an individual from Keysville, which is over near Lake Isabella Dam, wrote an article in the Visalia paper saying that the miners in that area feel that that strike on White River is a tail hold on a much larger strike to come. But we of the Kern River District feel like as such holds will all and soon slip away.
Yeah.
So they were competing for people to come to Kern River to mine.
That's who made the money, were the people that were selling to the miners.
That's exactly, exactly right. Now, we have an individual who lived in Porterville, Tulare County, famous individual called Dr. Samuel Greg George. And he was involved in selling properties over in the Owens Valley area and in the Kern River mines more than he was being a doctor. But then he is now our name for our E. Clampus Vitus group,
Clampers.
Dr. Samuel Greg George.
Oh, yeah.
And you mentioned Jim Savage. The Jim Savage chapter predated that up in the Mariposa, Coarse Gold, Fresno County area.
We have a good friend of the family that was a past humbug of the E. Clampus Vitus.
Yeah, I'm an ex-humbug.
Yeah. When we were coming into Porterville, we noticed that the population is about 55,000. Mm-hmm. And so what really pushed Porterville to grow?
The railroad came through here in 1889, and that caused it to boom. The first railroad in the 1870s came down the middle of the valley, which is where Fresno, Tipton, Pixley, Tulare City, where they are. But later, and at that time, everybody was a little upset because they thought the railroad would follow the old Stockton-Los Angeles road.
The stage line.
But the railroad would have had to purchase a lot of property.
Yeah.
So going down the middle of the valley.
It was given to them, wasn't it?
This property here for the railroad that came through Porterville in 1888 and 89 was purchased and dedicated to the railroad just to get, they purchased some, but most was dedicated just to get them through here.
Right.
And when that happened, the town boomed. This town picture shows the town in about 1890, and that's Main Street. At the end of Main Street is the first elementary and high school, which were a combination. And just there on the right side, what is called Central Hotel, was Porter Putnam's first building. And that side of the street was about all that was there until in the 1870s, Porter Putnam sold that side of the street to the Bakers and moved over to the west side and built a store there and put his home there next to the store. And that, along with the railroad, made the town boom.
Yeah, and then, of course, agriculture started and...
Well, the agriculture was here, the railroad coming here so that the agriculture would come here to be shipped, made the town.
Yeah. This is a fascinating museum. You have a lot of things here. We've been to quite a few museums, but I've never seen one as well-stocked as this one is.
Yeah, it's a little risky, but it does give people almost a hands-on look at everything that is from those early days.
And most of this stuff is from the local area, right?
Yeah, they're donated things by different families from the area and different businesses.
Now, this museum is open, what, Thursday, Friday, Saturday,
Thursday,
Sunday?
Friday, Saturday, not Sunday.
Not Sunday. So you're open 3 days a week.
3 days
so
a week.
So for people, if they come Monday to Wednesday, they'll miss it, but Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, you're open business hours, right?
Yes. They open in the summer at 9 a.m.
Yeah.
In the winter, they open at 10.
Yeah. So very good. And it looked like you had a pretty nice antique gun collection in there as well.
Yeah, that's some of the things I donated and some of the things that have been donated by many local people. We have items in there from the Revolutionary War period down through the Gold Rush era into modern times.
Well, Bill, we are out of time on this segment. Bill Horst with us on the Valley today here at the Porterville Museum, and certainly come down here. California has a relatively current history. California's not that old as far as the white man being here, and you can see a lot of the things that people used 100 years ago here at the Porterville Museum. With us is Eddie Davis now with his
gold panning rig.
It's
in the public interactive gold panning rig.
Yeah, and this will give people an idea of how hard it was actually to get gold 150 years ago.
Definitely gives them a chance.
160 years ago
That's not easy to find.
Yeah. Traveling exhibit that you take to different places?
That's correct, yes.
Go to a lot of schools, do
we
you?
We actually go all over the United States.
Excellent, yeah. But primarily in California, or?
No, we've been as far as Florida.
No kidding. So you're on the road a lot, I can imagine.
Oh, yeah.
Where does the gold now? You've got gold in here that people are looking for. And where does the gold come from?
It's coming out of the Kern River and also Nome, Alaska.
Yeah, and so if you're not finding the gold, then you probably have to buy it, I assume.
Buying from other prospectors, yeah.
And then so you pay whatever the market price for the day is.
That's about it. I'll do some trades.
The gold got up to almost $1,700.
It was actually as high as $1,850, something like that.
Now it's around
something around there. Yeah.
Now $1,330 around
it's,
there.
It's actually a little lower than that. Yeah. I think it's about $1,100.
How long have you been doing this?
It's been 23 years.
Wow. Yeah. You must like it because you're still doing it.
I'm still doing it. Yeah. Yes.
And so did you ever imagine, you probably are my age or maybe a little younger, did you ever imagine that when they went off the gold standard in 72 or 3, that it would go from market value of like $28 an ounce to where it is now?
Never thought it would happen. Actually, I remember when it was $210 an ounce and bought a lot of coins back then.
A lot of Cougarins or
maple leaves. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I never thought that it would actually jump as high as that.
Now you've got a gold nugget here, and that is maybe an ounce?
It's about two and a half.
Yeah, so that's roughly. You got about $4,000
right.
hanging on
there.
That's
it, yeah.
Don't hang around the wrappers too
we
close.
We tuck it down when yeah. it...
Now, where did that come from?
No, that came out of the current.
Okay, yeah. So it's
very an accidental find, actually.
It seems like the gold rush was more prevalent in the northern part of California from here, but certainly they were finding gold in the current.
That's right, that's yeah. right. Gold's been found as far as Nevada, so I mean, it's in all the rivers, but yeah. you have to be in the right place at the right time.
Right.
Gold is where you find it.
Yeah. You know? And of course, it migrates too, depending on what the water's
sure
doing.
Sure does.
You usually find it in the water and it comes downstream beds.
Storms, yeah. absolutely. Storms will, you know, a nice big storm will bring in some gold.
Are you an avid miner yourself, where you get in and get your hands wet
oh,
and
yeah.
you're doing it?
I get out there in the river.
Yeah.
I get out there dangerously in the river. I used to get out there dangerously in the river, yeah. yeah.
And that
yeah.
was probably foolish, but. Sure. And I know that the Kern River upstream coming out
it's
of Isabella.
A deadly that's, river.
That it's beautiful. That gorge is beautiful, but that water is fast, and I bet it's cold.
A lot of people get
yeah.
hurt in that
yeah,
river.
They sure yeah. do, yeah. So I've heard that we've only found 5% of the gold in the last 150 years. Is that any truth to that?
I really don't know the percentage, to be honest with
yeah.
you. But I can just say to you that there's a lot more gold to be found.
Yeah. All the easy stuff, the low fruit's been picked.
I'd say there's plenty more.
Yeah?
There's plenty more.
And it just keeps getting released from the higher Sierra deposits,
sure.
and they
mm-hmm.
keep washing downstream.
That's right.
And so I guess you look for a heavy runoff year?
That's usually when the pickings are good.
Mm-hmm.
That's usually when the pickings are good. You know, the places to look are under the boulders and, mm-hmm. you know, the big rocks on the edge.
So how long have you been here in Porterville?
I've been in this area for just about 22 years,
yeah,
about 23
but
years.
But your exhibit travels, so you're here for the summer?
I'm usually during the school season, I'm at schools, and in the summertime, I'm usually gone. I'm
yeah.
usually all over the
school. Where's your next great destination after Porterville, after the beautiful city of Porterville?
actually, we've,
you got
we
a
have
friend
a possibility.
There.
We have a possible... Arizona State Fair coming,
yeah.
Which is an 18-day fair. I just had a little chat with the fair yesterday.
And cool.
It's going to be a good one. That'll be a really good one.
Gold is running up and down the Sierra Nevadas. How high up? I guess as high as Alaska. And
absolutely.
And as far down as South America?
There's gold? I really don't. I couldn't. Say it for sure.
Okay.
I couldn't say for sure on that one.
All right.
But I wouldn't say that there wouldn't be because there is South American gold, which
yeah.
is a yellow or greenish gold.
Oh, so it has a slightly
has
different,
a different
color
look to it. Right.
Yeah.
yeah.
Now I'm wondering why he doesn't have a gold collar on.
We tried to give him a pan earlier.
Yeah. What's the bird's name?
This is Angel.
Angel. Oh, well, yeah. It's all white, so that makes sense, huh?
It's
so you can
up.
Come in here, and is there a fee to come in here and pan?
Here at the museum, there's a
yeah.
fee of $5 for a single, and what are we charging? $12 for three, and $15 for five.
Now, are you guaranteed to find gold?
We guarantee to find gold,
yeah.
yes, yes.
And so you get kids, this is very interactive, which is really cool.
Yes.
You know?
Everybody, they learn simple, common techniques of panning for gold,
mm-hmm.
and we'll teach a little bit extra, a little bit more.
Yeah.
And
now, could you give us a quick lesson?
Absolutely.
Okay. How about the bird? Does the bird know how to pan?
I don't know. I'm going to grab this pan right here.
All right.
Would you like to be the participant?
No, I'll just let
okay.
you do it. You just show me what you do.
In the gold rush gold panning rig, we dig front to back because there's the sand runs. It's a flume. So
okay.
Okay. So we're just going to dig straight down into the sand.
Yeah.
And we drag the bottom. And pull it up. We've got a pile of sand like this. Now there's
okay.
other things in the pan, such as river gems. We've got garnets and amethyst.
I noticed that she was pulling
right.
those out over there.
Right. There's citrine and really beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
But and then of course there's slope. Now here we've got a little piece of
right.
Looks like it might be
jade or something.
Jadeite or
yeah.
no, actually I think it might be some turquoise.
Mm-hmm.
So we set that up there. And then we just make, we have everybody make circles underwater.
Mm-hmm.
And
And gold is one of the heaviest elements in...
That's correct. Actually, the gold will... Sometimes it'll show up on the top like this. Now, see, there's some gold right there.
Oh, there's some gold right there.
All right, what we ask a lot of people... We ask our participants to do is to either push it down to the bottom with their finger or just shake the pan. Now, if you shake the pan a little bit, see how it sinks so easily?
Right.
Because it is the heaviest thing in the pan. And the sand, there's these larger particles. These are actually big enough and light enough to just fall off the edges of the pan.
Mm-hmm.
So we make big circles underwater. Now and then give it a little shake.
Mm-hmm.
Continue with the circles. Now you see how the sand comes off every time I make a circle.
Right.
That little takes off a layer of sand. We're not using turbulence to move the sand on this. We're just using the weight of the water.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes we get some actual prospectors in and we give them a new technique. We usually give them a new technique.
They've been doing it for years and they said, I never did it that way.
Right, yeah. And they'll do this kind of a fast shaking method. And it's
a lot of guys have probably lost a gold bearing ore because of they didn't do it properly.
That is correct. That is correct. Their technique is rough. And they learn from each other, and the way their grandfather taught them and so on down the road. And I had one guy in here that got a big pile of sand and he put his hand in there and went like this every time he got the pan. He came up with no gold every time.
And I finally asked him,
where'd you learn that? And I was trying to ease him. I didn't want to hurt his feelings, and I said, try not doing that this time.
Yeah.
And so then I kind of guided his hand a little bit.
Guy had been panning for 50 years and couldn't figure out why he had never gotten any gold.
That's right. That's right. And and so he finally panned it out and got a couple of flakes out of it.
Yeah.
And I learned the way to do this. All right. Now we definitely know we have gold in this. Now you see, as I'm going to bring up this pan, see there's. All you can see here is you got the black sand in here,
right.
You got lighter particles of sand there, but still the gold is at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Now, sometimes people get discouraged, and they'll dump the pan at this point, and too bad, there goes that nugget or that flake, and it's gone, But, of course, the sad stories are the ones the child comes up and, well, that was one story. You want to hear a story?
Sure.
Okay. I was at an attraction at a fair once, and this little girl, about 13, and she got a nugget. She actually found a nugget about the size of my fingernail.
Yeah.
And, she got the nugget, and everybody was, wow, oh my gosh, let me see. All the participants were looking, and, I said, hold on to the nugget. I left it in her pan. I said, I'll go get you a bottle. So I went down, went and got a bottle, came back, and the nugget's gone. And I said, where's the nugget? She says, I threw it back because I wanted to get a bigger one.
Now that's optimistic.
It was really optimistic.
Well, you got a couple of pieces of gold there.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, what kind of gold is that? Is that a flake, or?
That's called placer gold, okay? This is placer gold, which is riverborne.
Right,
riverborne gold. There's your gold.
Show that right in the camera. You got a good shot of that, Charles?
Yes, I do.
Oh, look at that. Very nice.
It's got a little, some thickness to it, too. It's not, now that's a placer gold. That actually has gem quality. It has a higher value than refined gold, so it's got more, a 1 ounce nugget of placer compared to a 1 ounce coin, the nugget is actually worth more.
I think the most interesting piece of gold I ever saw was in the Mariposa Museum, and it was that crystalline gold.
Okay,
really
right.
Really interesting.
Right.
We're almost out of time, Eddie.
Okay.
What advice do you have for people that want to quit their day job and go out in the fields and try to find gold?
First I'll say, don't quit your day job. take your fishing pole, take your gold panning pan, and do it like that.
Right.
And catch a fish, pan some gold,
Now, is there still quite a bit of gold in the valley floor, do you think?
Yes, I do. Yes. Okay. I've found it up in the Tule. It's here. It's here, currently here. Mm-hmm. The time to go is not when the river is rushing too hard.
Right. It's after it's subsided.
That's right.
And after a heavy storm year that's washed everything down.
That's right.
Then that's the time to start
looking. That's the time to go. And if you can move a boulder or a rock along the side, good luck to you.
Just like a Pale Rider.